So when I look at the tree of eukaryotic life, one of the things that strikes me is how frequently we see the signature of polyphony in that tree. And so here I've shown you a tree where we see these ancient polyphony events shown with these red stars kind of throughout in all of our different taxa. And so we see them at the base of the telos fish, the angiosperms, the sea plants, and the group that I'm going to focus more on today, which is the Saccharomyces, which is extremely important for many of the things that we like to do, especially at nighttime conferences. Oh, I'm sorry. And so this is work that I'm going to tell you that really started when I was a graduate student. And this is the first talk I ever gave at an evolution meeting in 2005, which was in Alaska, where I talked about rapid evolution of genome size in yeast. And this is work that's been kind of ongoing on the side ever since then. And so what I presented at that meeting was an experiment where we set out to experimentally test the influence of ploidy on the rate of adaptation. So using fungal microbes, we have this incredible ability to control the genome. And so we can take haploid yeast and create diploids and tetraploids that have the exact same gene complement, so they're homozygous, they just differ in ploidy. And so we can conduct experiments where we've manipulated the ploidy to test theories about how evolution works when you have different ploidy levels. And so we set out what we thought was a fairly simple experiment to take haploid, diploid, and tetraploid yeast. We evolve them in test tubes in this sort of Lenski-style experimental cell where you put in a number of cells into a very confined media. You let the cells grow up for 24 hours until they use the majority of the resources. You come back the next day, you transfer again this subset of the cells, usually about 100 dilutions. And you can do this again and again. And so we did this for about almost 2,000 generations with the idea that at the end of the time we would compare the haploids that was in touch with and see who was most fit. When we did that, what we found instead was that all of our lines had converged towards diploidy. So we had lines of also both rich medium and salt-stress medium. The haploids are shown in red, the tetraploids are in yellow. These are snapshots of what was happening during evolution. So each point just represents one colony that we picked from the population. So when you see lines going up and down, it's not the whole population going up and down, it's just there's polymorphism in ploidy at those different time points. What we saw was very striking. Haploid went up, tetraploid went down. The rates may have been different than two different environments, but this was really surprising to us. And years since then, it turns out not to be that surprising at all. And whenever people have done these ploidy evolution experiments, they've seen the same thing in really diverse fungal microbes. And we see it not only with species like Saccharomyces cerevisiae, which has a baseline ploidy of diploid, but also in species that have a baseline ploidy of haploid. And so we're seeing this pattern of ploidy transition toward baseline ploidy. I think almost every time anyone has ever done test tube evolution in fungal. And so I published a paper with my collaborator, Malia Hickman, this year, where we define this phenomenon as ploidy drive, which we're defining as the force acting on a lineage to revert back to its baseline ploidy. And I think this has a lot of, relates a lot to what we see in our eukaryotic tree, because we see these ancient polyphonization events, and then a lot of these pieces end up back in diploid, so they're re-diploidizing. The time scales are different. This in these trees are generally happening around shorter time scales. This idea that there's something beneficial about having an increased genome size, but then you end up back at baseline ploidy, so I think that's a very similar concept. And so what I'm going to tell you about today is sort of an investigative journalism report of what's actually happening here. And so I'm going to follow the same framework as a journalist because I'm a biologist, so why should I reinvent the wheel? And so I'm going to tell you what we know since 2006 about this phenomenon and what we've learned. So who? As I told you, ploidy drive occurs throughout divergent fungal taxa, so the yellow stars indicate the taxa we've observed it in. For scale, here's some of our favorite organisms, so Humus and sticklebacks, and so you can see these are really divergent fungal taxa, and even though to my eyes they look really similar, evolutionarily they're not. And so this seems to be sort of this conserved phenomenon among the fungi. We're seeing, as I told you, both increases and decreases, always towards the baseline ploidy, so haploids can double up to diploids, and diploids can go down to haploids, and tetraploids can go up to diploids, and so it seems like, depending on the species, they can do sort of all the things. We're seeing this in a large diverse of environments, so these are experiments that I've done, but also in many other labs. We see it in YPD, which is our sort of generic rich medium for fungal evolution in the lab. We see it under diverse stresses like that are relevant to yeast, like ethanol and salt. We see it happening in the drugs that we use to treat fungal infections, like fluconazole, and we're seeing it in a variety of different nutrient orientation environments. So again, it's like every environment we've looked at, we're seeing this phenomenon. We also see it during different experiment types and evolution different population sizes. So our experiments were all done in batch culture, where we do these Lenski-style boom and bust sort of nutrient experiments, and so we thought maybe it's something about batch culture that's selecting for it. also to get in continuous culture experiments. So these are experiments where you're evolving these in these culture vessels where you're constantly putting in new nutrients. So there is no sort of seasonality in nutrients. And we also see it in mutation accumulation experiments that are done at very low population sizes. So we're seeing in these high population sizes where selection is really efficient in batch and continuous culture and also in mutation accumulation experiments. The rate of plate conversions does seem to depend on both the species and the environment. So I know this is a little bit complicated, so I'm going to talk through as well. So this is presenting results from two different experiments, one in Saccharomyces and one in Candida albicans. In both experiments, we took the same genetic backgrounds and we evolved them simultaneously in both rich medium and salt stress medium in Saccharomyces, and rich medium and under nitrogen and phosphorus deprivation in Candida. In the Candida graphs, the two symbols are two different genetic backgrounds, although they're quite similar, so they're both related to the lab strain. And what we see if we just plot the rate of convergence to diploid, so the tetraploids are going down, the haploids are going up, is that depending on the environment, this is happening at different times. So in Saccharomyces, in both of our environments, the tetraploids are converging to diploid faster than the haploids. But if we compare within an environment, the tetraploids are converging faster in rich medium compared to in salt, whereas the haploids are converging faster in salt compared to the rich. And we see a different but similar pattern where there's this, again, relationship between the environment and the initial plate. So in our Canada experiments, the haploids converge fastest in rich medium compared to the nutrient deprivation, whereas our tetraploids converge to diploid faster in phosphorus deprivation. So that's, I think, a really important point, which is that the environment is influencing the dynamics of this situation. So there's some rule for selection happening here. However, if we carry out these experiments for long enough, everything will go back to plate. So it's not enough to prevent it from happening. We're also seeing this happen really quickly. Again, these numbers are from different experiments, and so it might well be the case that they would be more similar if we did the same experiments under the same conditions in the same lab. But the point is that this is really fast. So 10 generations, that's like almost nothing. And so if we think about how we expect selection to be working, it's actually really fast compared to what the effect size of a single chromosomal loss or single mutation would be. So this is almost like I would treat it as like a back of the envelope calculation. But if we look at the required fitness benefit against the time to reach 50% frequency in a population, even with fully dominant mutations, so those shown in the black line, it takes a really long time compared to how quickly we're seeing this to happen to see these mutations be able to like sweep through the populations. And so it's happening really quickly compared to how we normally think about how mutations arrive in populations and sweep through based on their effect size. And again, a lot of these are done at really high population sizes where you expect selection to be acting efficiently. So the how is where we start getting into the mystery of it. Because although we know that haploids can double up to diploidy, doing sort of this thing called endoduplication or endoreplication, where they essentially undergo mitosis and then fail to divide, the mechanism by which diploidy reduction happens mitotically is kind of a mystery. And we're seeing, it's a little bit hard with the sampling because we're doing everything at the population level, but we see these approximate euploid shifts often, so tetraploids to triploid-ish to diploid-ish. They usually have a few extra chromosomes though, they're not perfect in the middle. And so we're seeing maybe one step some of the time, maybe two steps some of the time, but then also we see these N-euploids popping up very frequently, which suggests multiple events happening on their transition down to diploidy. And if you remember back to first year of high school biology about the comparison between mitosis and meiosis, mitosis doesn't really have a framework for being able to track chromosomes. And so in meiosis, in metaphase, you end up with sort of the tetrarchs positioned at the metaphase plate. And so you see that you know both copies of chromosome 1 are pairing together. In mitosis, that's not true. So in the schematic, of course, they've lined them up nicely by chromosome, but that's not necessarily what's happening. And so since mitosis doesn't involve the pairing of chromosomes, how do they end up sort of dropping down to go through these euploid shifts in ploidy? And so this suggests a role for either mitotic recombination or these errant meiosis-like events that are happening in the framework of mitosis. And I should say that at least a few of the taxa, including Candida albicans, sex can happen if you kind of force it in the lab, but we don't have very much evidence for sex in nature. However, they still have all the genes that they need to have sexual have sex, and so it might be that why those genes are being maintained in the genome could be for errant things like this that are happening. And so then the other question is, okay, why is this happening? So if we think about ploidy transitions, we start with a population, let's say, of haploid cells, and they end up in diploids. So there's this intermediate timeline where we have both haploids and diploids in the population. And we know that diploidy is going to take over, and so you might just think, okay, well, the diploids are just better. They arise in haploid background, and then they just take over because they're simply better. And we know that plenty of diversity does exist within natural populations. So if we look at Canada albicans, if we look at our lab test tubes, we see they're pretty much all diploid. But as soon as we add a stressor, put them through mice, or take a, or sample our clinical isolates, we do see variation plenty occurring. The other species I worked on a lot as a postdoc is cryptococcinate formans. So these are both human fungal pathogens. They are generally fine if you have a normal immune system. If your immune system gets compromised, they become pathogenic. And so in the case of cryptococcus, it is in the lungs, it's usually a haploid, but we have seen in recent years these giant Titan cells in the lung environment, which are polyploid. A lot of them are tetraploid, but we've seen up to like 64N. We know that they're important in the case of human virulence. This is a human macrophage. And these are obviously artificially colored. So this is a haploid normal crypto cell. The Titan cells are so large that the macrophage can't even engulf them. So this is a really good strategy to just be so big to avoid the human immune system. And when you remove Titan cells from the population, we know that Canada is, the immune system deals with Canada much more readily. And so they are playing a really important role. And so we see this plenty of diversity. And as soon as we take our crypto populations out of the lungs, they immediately go back to haploid. And the Titan cells are biting off what looks like haploid cells. So there's this mechanism that exists. So we would think that there it should be okay to be a polyploid cell. We see these in nature, and so going back to our experiments, we expect that there should be a fitness benefit in ancestral state. So there's just some reason that these cells are better. And so what we did was we took a time series across one of our Saccharomyces lines. So we sampled for haploids and diploids. We isolated the diploids and the haploids from the last time point where we saw that they're in the population together, and then the diploid population from right after diploid gets left. And we competed diploids against that haploid population. So what we expected was that the diploids would do better, because that's what we saw, that's what happened. And yet that's not what happened in our these experiments. And so we competed the diploid population from this time point, they did worse than the haploids. So this is increases in diploids, increases in haploids. When we took different diploid colonies, they almost all did worse. There's also a lot of variation among them. And yet when we took that final diploid population up here, it did do better. So something happened in between those two time points. Furthermore, the haploids are adapting faster than the diploids, and yet diploids are taking over. And so if we combine all of our experiments together, then we evolve haploids and diploids in YP and salt for a fairly short time, we see the haploids significantly adapting faster than the diploids. Yet the original experiments I showed you, the diploids take over. Of the mystery. And so to summarize what I've shown you, fungal genomes are super labile and incredibly tolerant of karyotypic variation. And if you think about humans, we are not tolerant of karyotypic variation. So this is very different from what we're seeing in other taxa. It suggests that some novel mitotic cell cycle control mechanisms are waiting to be discovered. I'm not a cell biologist, but I keep waiting for someone to just sit in front of a microscope for like 3 days and just track the chromosomes, which is something we can do. And it suggests a role for both mutation and selection. So we see diploids arising from mutation accumulation at low population sizes, so this mutation is happening. And we saw a diversity of diploid phenotypes, which suggests that these are different diploids, and so they're probably repeatedly evolving. But we also saw the rate dependent on the environment, and I didn't show you so much, also on the genetic background. So there's a role for both of these things to be happening. And so this pretty well actually sums up what I think is happening in the system. And with that, I would like to acknowledge a ton of excellent undergrads I worked with through the years, help with these technical assistants, and I am very privileged to be Canadian, but I wanted to point out that I've had independent fellowship support throughout my academic career, which has allowed me to sort of carry on my independent research program at the Grattan Institute.